Hello, welcome back to theCUBE. We are here wrapping up our day three. We got two more interviews left. We're going to break it down. It's media week with the bell ringing going on right now during this segment. My favorite part of theCUBE at our East Coast studio here at the NYSE. Of course, we got the Palo Alto connecting Wall Street with Silicon Valley, creating an open network. The NYSE CUBE Wired Network is an open source team of experts here all contributing into theCUBE content. Anand is here, he's the CEO of Aira. We were just talking about his Intel days, a legend in the industry. Great to see you. Thanks for
great
coming
to see
on the
you,
Cube.
John. Thanks for having me.
First time on theCUBE, but you know, we've seen each other around, going back on glory days, story about Centrino, Chip said you worked on a lot of the key products at Intel.
Yeah.
What's Aira doing? Give a quick update, then we can jump in.
So Aira Technologies was formed with a very single mission. Our view is there's a tremendous amount of opportunity in wireless cellular networks in particular, because a lot of the data is not being used, right? And using machine learning and AI, you can use that data and substantially improve performance. Not only improve performance, we believe the cellular networks can be autonomous. In an age where we're talking about cars being autonomous, planes being autonomous, and trains, it's criminal that your wireless network is not autonomous or is not being talked about being autonomous. So our mission is to make the cellular networks autonomous and in the process, release efficiencies and performance that's going to delight customers like you and I on the network, as well as delight the operators that have to run it.
Okay, so performance, let's just take a pause there because there's a lot to unpack there. Are you referring to performance of the actual radios themselves, the spectrum, the connectivity, or all of the above? What data specifically are you referring to?
So there are two, the technologies that we've developed fall broadly into two categories, right? And now if you'll allow me, I'll just back up a little bit and do a wide angle view of what's going on in an operator environment, right? Every telco around the globe is facing a challenge in that the data that is being transferred on their network is going like this, right? Going from bottom left to top right, right? That demand for more data on the networks translates almost directly into a demand for CapEx, right? CapEx is going up similarly, right? However, about the same time, their average revenue per unit is not doing that. It's flat to slightly up, right? So as a consequence, there's a tremendous amount of pressure on the OPEX side of it, right? So if our take was, if there is a way, and I'll add one more point, cellular networks today cover maybe a billion connections, right? That's soon going to be trillion connections, right? Pick the time frame, whether it's 5 years or 6 years, it's going to happen. Now, there are not a trillion people on the planet, but there are a lot of things on the planet, and we people like to connect things to things and things to people, and that's where the trillion connections come from. And anytime you have an order of magnitude change like that, the conventional way of approaching improvement in spectrum performance or efficiencies won't work. You've got to look at it freshly. So we look at a bit of a long-winded way of saying, why do we do what we do? And the technology we've developed approaches two aspects of this problem. We approach OPEX, and we approach CapEx, right? So let's start with the OPEX first, right? OPEX is, we look at how do you improve the productivity of an RF engineer. RF engineers are the guys running these networks.
Yeah.
Deep, deep technology guys know a lot, but they're not necessarily software programmers, right? And their jobs are getting hard and getting harder as you look at the complexity of the networks going up, right? So what we're doing is we've invented this or developed this software platform called Navic. Navic is a Gen AI plus traditional AI based software platform that helps automate a lot of the routine tasks an RF engineer does, right?
Like what?
So for example, if you wanted to observe and analyze the network and pick up.
Hold on. Hold that thought. The bell's ringing, closing bell right now here on the big day where President-elect Trump came in, first president since Ronald Reagan to come to the NYSE, closing out a pretty spectacular day of chaos, security. Here it is.
There it goes.
And there's the special crew.
A lot of red on that board today. I'm not sure what that means. All right, so big day today. Obviously, Donald Trump here, president-elect, came in. A lot of fanfare, certainly. A lot of excitement talking about the business of the company, country. First president since Ronald Reagan.
Yeah.
So pretty historic.
Huge.
Okay,
yeah.
So go back to the CapEx.
Yeah.
OpEx. You're an OpEx engineer, does what tasks?
So for example, today if you wanted to observe and analyze the network and say, hey, what's going on in downtown New York City near the Wall Street area, right? You would have to write scripts, programs to extract the information out of the network and then plot graph, et cetera. With our NAVIC platform, you simply query it in English. NAVIC will go scan the various databases, pull it, will write the code that it does that, and it will just present it to you in the way you need to see it, right? I'm just giving the most trivial example that it does, right?
Yep.
It gets a lot more sophisticated beyond that. It can do anomaly detection, it can do root cause analysis. You can even write small automations or complex automations using NAVIC and then deploy it instead of having your IT group do it or wherever you would go to, right? So all of those things improve the efficiency of the RF engineers in the company.
Productivity, check.
Exactly.
CapEx, that's the hard line.
CapEx is the hard one, right? So CapEx, what we do is we've developed this technology again that allows us to do a much better job of beam management. So how do we do that, right? So we're able to classify.
What kind of management?
Beam management.
Okay, the
task of forming the beam itself, right? And the way we do that is we actually are able to classify at the base station, right, the personality of the base station. Machine learning is actually phenomenal for classification, right?
Yeah.
So we use those classification capabilities to determine, is the base station sitting in downtown New York City near Wall Street, or is it near Hudson someplace, right?
Yeah.
You can determine that personality, and then by how do we determine that? Well, we can assess the SNR, we can assess the delay spread.
So the spread rate, so basically you know the environment it's kicking into, there's a lot of trees in the area, I want to go over them.
Exactly, we were talking about trees earlier, right? Exactly. And once you know that environment, you can actually do a much better job of forming the beam using the
machine learning. So if there's a big event, like a festival, you can organize the beams for higher concentration and high density?
Exactly, right? So with that technology, we're able to improve spectral efficiency on average by about 2x.
I mean, everyone's had their phones on 5 bars and no video uploads.
That's right.
That's, you solved that problem.
We solved that. Right.
That's a real problem. Everyone's experienced that.
Exactly right. So that's how we attack those two things, right?
Yeah.
The OpEx solutions are easier to kind of roll out into the marketplace. These the CapEx
domain
ones.
Expertise, look at the workflows.
Exactly.
Chip away at those. You'll knock those out in a heartbeat. But the CapEx is the true tuning of the signal.
That's right.
Of how that's going to work. And you can know things like it's a highway.
Exactly right.
Speed.
Yes.
That's awesome. So that's a good business model.
It is.
Well, what kind of funding? You must have a boatload of funding.
Not a boatload of funding, because we are targeting telco.
Okay.
If we were a pure AI company, our funding would be astronomical. But we're applying AI to telco.
Yeah. They're transforming very fast.
They are.
I mean, they're getting the business model transformation.
Absolutely. And so that's pretty exciting. We just closed our Series B, and this was a strategic round that we did. We raised $15 million, and we had Juniper Networks participated, with Intel Capital participated, AT&T participated, and that's huge for us.
Yeah.
And we also had the Incutel participate in this round.
Yeah.
So we're good right now on money, and we've got customers. And
And then you also got all kinds of agility edge network scenarios.
Exactly.
You know, pop-up cellular for events. You got edge of the network. You got computer vision coming around the pike. You mentioned cars traveling by, uploading. The old vision was, you know, driving down the highway and you upload as these upload stations.
That's
these
right.
These towers are taking in uploads.
Yes. Actually, when you look at AI, AI is actually changing the way the traffic is actually being consumed. So historically, you cared mostly about downlink in terms of performance, right? With AI, you're actually also sending up a lot of data on the uplink, right? That's a paradigm shift as well. So all of this adds to complexity on these networks, and we are trying to use AI.
Well, we'll do a deeper dive in Palo Alto, and I know we got a tough schedule today from the Trump disruption. Let's get into some of the business milestones. Give a quick update on the business momentum and what you guys are doing, some of the highlights, some of the things you're working on, maybe a plug into what you're trying to hire, some of the growth strategies.
Yep.
Take a minute to explain some of the business objectives and goals and milestones.
So from a business standpoint, we're largely focused very much right now on getting our core platform, NAVIC, into the marketplace. We first started talking about that about a year and a half ago, and now we're engaged solidly with several customers. Those customer relationships, unfortunately, are not public, so I can't talk about the customers.
Yep.
But there's a very large customer in the U.S., several overseas, that are basically going to go to market with this product, right? Mm-hmm. And Navik, as I said, is a, the reason I call it a platform is it has a lot of suites. So energy savings, for example, which has been a big issue, and to put that in perspective, that's one of the things that we are making a big dent on. 2 to 3% of energy consumption on a global basis is telecoms, right? Out of that 2 to 3%, 60% of that energy consumption is in the radio access network in telecoms. Out of that, half is on the radio sitting on the tower, right? Our energy saving solutions takes a technique out of the PC world, throttling. When you're not using the PC, it actually goes to sleep. We're taking that same idea, applying it to radios, and we showed this summer at a trade show in Copenhagen.
Saves power.
Yeah, we save 25%.
You can put
power.
A GPU right there too, more horsepower.
Exactly.
Just use that power, recycle that power.
That's right, that's one way you could do it.
What do you think about Open RAN?
Open RAN is a phenomenal idea. Open RAN needs to happen because it will speed innovation in the telco industry. And I kind of liken Open RAN to what happened to the computing industry between the 1980s and 2000. A vertical industry became horizontal, right?
Yeah.
However,
open standards come in,
exactly.
A lot of disruption, a lot of enablement.
Exactly, right? However, it's been slow to take off, right? I think very slow to take off, right? It's been operator-led initiative. It's been relatively slow to take off. Governments are pushing it. I think it'll eventually happen, but so far, it's been.
Anand, great to have you on theCUBE. We'll certainly do a deeper dive. Mobile
Likewise.
World Congress is coming up.
Yes,
we'll have
you'll be
on.
There.
I'll be there. And come next week to our event. And we're going to be in Palo Alto for our AI CFO event on 17th, and then AI Innovators. Your friend Shreem's going to be on, I think he's going to be on.
Yes.
He's going to come on theCUBE. All the Intel alumni are out there innovating. It's the Intel Mafia. They're out there creating companies, continuing to do well. I call them the OGs. I want to go to the Intel. I won't say what the current situation is there. Plenty of time in our hour podcast for that one.
We can. It's unfortunate what's going on. I wish them well.
Yeah, but we remember the glory days. I'm John Furrier with theCUBE. Stay with us. Thanks for watching.